Turn to Ecclesiastes chapter 9. We're going to be looking at this entire chapter. Don't be afraid. I know you're like, wait, that's a lot of verses. I got to go to Chili's here. Don't worry about it. I'll be done before that. But it's going to be a great study here. The message I've entitled this morning is called Reality Check. So you're going to have a reality check this morning. And we'll be looking at verses, or chapter 9, the whole chapter pretty much. I'm going to read the chapter, and that way we can go through for the sake of context. But in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, as Solomon is writing, Solomon says, "For I considered all this in my heart, so that I could declare it all, that the righteous and the wise and their works are in the hand of God. People know neither love nor hatred by anything they see before them. All things come alike to all. One event happens to the righteous and the wicked, to the good, the clean, and the unclean, to him who sacrifices and to him who does not sacrifice. As is the good, so is the sinner. He who takes an oath as he who fears an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun. That one thing happens to all. Truly the hearts of the sons of men are full of evil. Madness is in their hearts while they live and after they go to the dead. But for him who is joined to all the living, there is hope. For a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing, and they have no more reward. For the memory of them is forgotten. Also their love, their hatred, and their envy have now perished. Nevermore will they have a share in anything done under the sun. Go eat your bread with joy, and drink your wine with a merry heart. For God has already accepted your works. Let your garments always be white, and let your head lack no oil. Live joyfully with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life, which he has given you under the sun, all your days of vanity. For that is your portion in life and in the labor which you perform under the sun. Whatever your hands finds to do, do it with all your might. For there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you are going. I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happen to them all. For man does not know his time. Like a fish taken in a cruel net, like birds caught in a snare, so the sons of men are snared in an evil time when it falls suddenly upon them. This wisdom I have also seen under the sun. And it seemed great to me. There was a little city with few men in it, and a great king came against it, besieged it, and built great snares around it. Now there was found in it a poor wise man, and he by his wisdom delivered the city. Yet no one remembered that same poor man. Then I said, wisdom is better than strength. Nevertheless, the poor man's wisdom is despised, and his words are not heard. Words of the wise spoken quietly should be heard rather than the shout of a ruler of fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. Over the past few years, television has been filled with reality shows that are not reality. I mean, if you think about it, in reality, you and I will not be stranded on a deserted island and forced to survive. I don't think any of you guys have gone through that. I've never been through that. If you have, I want to talk to you afterwards. Not only that, but guys, single people, let me just say this. You're probably not going to have the opportunity to pick a spouse from a group of model-type people who are competing to marry you. I don't know about that, right? You know, sometimes the single people, I've talked to many, you know, they're praying for their spouse, they can't find a spouse and whatnot. So, you know, I mean, you could pray for a group, but I doubt that. Not only that, but as you go throughout the reality TV shows, we're not going to eat worms, walk across the top of a moving semi-truck for $1 million. We're not going to have our houses extremely made over in a week. Perhaps these shows would be better labeled as escape from reality. And let me ask you this. Are you dealing with reality? Or are you trying to escape reality? You see, the book of Ecclesiastes is one of those books that you miss in the Bible. It's in there. You thumb through the Psalms and you go through Ecclesiastes. And when you make the attempt to read Ecclesiastes, you're like, what is this? This guy's talking about life, and it's depressing. I mean, in chapter 1, he says, life stinks. That's my interpretation. His observation about life is like, I see people being oppressed. I see people who are depressed. I see people that are working very hard, and they die. Life stinks. That's his premise. That's the way he starts Ecclesiastes. It's interesting, too, that as you get into the book, and we're going to look at this here, that when he talks about death, he's got an interesting perspective. In fact, Jehovah's Witnesses will take this book, and they will build the doctrine of annihilation by reading Ecclesiastes. We're going to go through some things in here that you're going to be like, whoa, wait a minute here. But I'm going to explain these things to you so you're not coming out of here dizzy, spiritually, if you will. But the book of Ecclesiastes is a fascinating book, and I believe that this book is in this Bible to give us a reality check. Because when we look at this book, we're going to be looking at this, that Solomon delves into the hard issues of life and attempts to find satisfactory answers that prevent despair. How can you live a life without dealing with despair? How can I live my life on this side of heaven without suffering, without going through all of that chaos that we see in this world? That's the whole thing about Ecclesiastes. This morning, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you four reality checks that are in life. And I'll begin with the first one, based on verse 1 here. Reality check number 1, we are not the sovereign masters of our destiny. Notice what it says in verse 1. He says it very clearly. He says, I considered all this in my heart, so that I could declare it all, that the righteous and the wise and their works are in the hand of God. Unquestionable truth right there. Under the hand of God. Solomon acknowledges here in the very first verse of chapter 9 that God is sovereign over everything and everyone right away. And we see that in Proverbs 21, verse 1, Solomon said this about the sovereignty of God. He says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. He directs it like a water course wherever he pleases. Isn't that great? Hey, listen, we are about, in our nation, we're about to change presidents. When I read this verse, I'm like, amen to that, Lord. Those candidates are not in full control. God is in full control. So there's peace, there's comfort in my heart. And we see that Solomon himself made it very clear that the heart, the king's heart, is in God's hand. And he directs it like a water course. I love that. David said this about life, Psalm 31:15, my times are in your hands. Deliver me from my enemies and from those who pursue me. I love that. My times are in your hands. And that's true for all of us in here. There's a story in the New Testament that Jesus gave. It was actually a parable about a rich man. And this rich man yielded a bunch of crops. He was already rich. And, you know, for some reason, this rich guy was able to accrue tons of crops. It was a good year for him. And he said something interesting, and I'm going to read it to you. You don't have to actually turn there. But when he saw this crops and all of this stuff, he said, you know what? I don't have room in my barns to put them in. So what did he do? This is what he said. Jesus said this. He thought within himself, saying, what shall I do since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns, build greater, and there I will store all my crops, all my goods. And I will say to my soul, you're the man. That's my interpretation, all right? He didn't say that. He said this, and I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take it ease. Take your ease. Eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, notice this now, fool. He didn't say, what a wise man. Fool. Why? This night, your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? Ouch. He was going to die. And here he thought he was on top of the world. He was like, hey, this is great. I'm on top of the world. I got it made. You know, Solomon acknowledges here that God is sovereign over everything. And here we see that this man himself is actually thinking that he has everything that he needs and there's no reason to disturb his life. And yet God says, no, I'm in control here. And little do you know that you're going to die today. So all of the stuff that you have, who's it going to go to? Solomon adds that you will neither know love nor hatred. He says it here. What does that mean? Literally, it means whether it will be love or hate, no one knows. In other words, what he's saying is this: we don't know God's providence, neither do we know whether we are going to be objects of love or objects of hatred. We don't see it coming. We don't see love coming. We don't see hatred coming. We just don't know. Solomon's point is this: there are no guarantees as to what life will bring. That's his whole point. We just don't know. God knows, because he's sovereign. He knows. He knows the future. You guys remember the movie Forrest Gump? Remember that little quote, that little saying that he said? Everybody gets, you know, and quotes it. I'm going to quote it today. This is what he said. Mama always says that life was like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. Right? Remember that? That's the only part I could do. That's true, though. Seriously. Yeah, that's a movie, but that's true, because life is full of surprises. Listen, if you've been living life for a very long time, you know life is full of surprises, right? You know it is. If you're young, you're like, no, it's not. Wait until you get there. Life is full of surprises. And we see here very clearly that no one will never know whether what will happen next. And the thing is this: you are not in control of that. That's the hard thing about life. That because life is full of surprises, we don't know what's coming next, yet we don't have control over that at all. Proverbs 27:1 says this: do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day will bring. We don't know whether we're going to be objects of love, objects of hatred. In fact, that crazy Uber driver that shot those people, they didn't know that they were going to be objects of hatred. They didn't realize that that day was their last day. As they were walking on the street, a guy pulls over and shoots them. They didn't know that. That's what Solomon is kind of saying here. But we don't know whether we're going to be objects of love or objects of hatred. But there is a certainty that I want to tell you about. There's one certainty in life, and you can count on this certainty. And that certainty is this: is that God is involved in the lives of those who trust Him. So don't worry. But Robert, you see how the world's going? I mean, terrorism is here now, and all the things that are happening. I can't even take an Uber car because now I don't even know what this guy's going to do. Listen, one, God is in control, and two, trust Him. He is involved in your life. He cares for you. Jesus said this: I will never leave you and what? Forsake you. That's a promise. He's with you here. He's with you as you leave. And this is a promise. So reality check is this: that God is the one who's in control. We are not masters of our own destiny. We're not the sovereign master of our own destiny. Reality check number two: we are going to die. You're like, well, yeah, I know that. No, seriously. There are people that live their lives like if they're not going to die. I was on the freeway recently. As I'm driving, I hear this loud noise coming from behind me. I don't know what it was. It's, you know, those noises that you're like, you're looking up side, you know, you're like, what is this, a drone? You know what I mean? I mean, something really loud. And all of a sudden, this motorcycle flies by me at least 100 miles per hour, zooming by. And if it was you here, you're in trouble. No, he was 100 miles per hour. And I'm thinking, the first thing that came to my mind, I'm like, you know what, dude, if a car caught, you know, crossed in front of you, you are done. And I'm thinking, doesn't this guy have fear that one false move, this guy is gone. He's going to get hurt big time, if not die. And people live like that. They think that, oh, no, I'm not going to die. No, I'm fine. Well, reality check number two is that we are going to die. Death is a common destiny for all people. For all people. Solomon can actually summarize verses 2 and 3 here with the words, under the sun, you're done. He could really summarize it in that way. I read a story recently about three guys, good friends, a doctor, a teacher, and a comedian, that were actually hanging out to fellowship. As they were driving, their car crashed, and they rolled over, and they all three died, unfortunately, all of them. So they were ushered into heaven, and they were in this waiting room, an orientation kind of thing, and an angel comes to the first guy, the doctor, and he said, hey, listen, what do you want to hear people say at your funeral? So the doctor sat for a moment, he's thinking, well, I want to hear people say at my funeral that I was a good doctor and I saved many lives. Okay. He goes to the teacher and he says, "Teacher, what do you want to hear people say at your funeral?" He said, "Well, I want to hear people say at my funeral that I was a good dad, I love my children, my wife, and that I influenced a lot of people in the school system for the Lord." So the angel goes to the comedian. He says, "So what do you want to hear people say at your funeral?" And he's kind of thought for a moment. "I want to hear people say, 'Look, he's moving.'" I'll let you guys think about that one. The first service, it was 10 minutes later they left. Death is one of those subjects we just don't like to talk about, right? I mean, if you were to call a friend today and say, "Hey, I want you to come over for coffee. I want to talk about death with you." You wouldn't have friends. You know what I'm saying? Death is something we don't want to talk about. It's weird. You know, sometimes people will shush you. "Shh, no, don't talk. Don't say that." "Well, what do you mean?" Well, listen, death is a subject, of course, that people don't want to talk about. I mean, there are magazines that, you know, there's a magazine called Life. I've never run into a magazine called Death. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that sounds morbid, doesn't it? I guarantee you there'll be people that would buy that magazine, but the majority of the people wouldn't buy or touch a magazine called Death. Life, I'll buy that. But we see, though, very clearly that people don't want to talk about death, and instead of using the words dead, died, we say things like passed away, returned home, or they've gone to a better place, because after all, death is a depressing subject. It really is. Most of us, I'm sure all of us here, have been in that lounge waiting room waiting to get your name called in to go see your doctor. You know that holding tank, I call it, right? You're sitting in there waiting for that nurse come through and say, "Mr. Baltadano, doctor would like to see you," and you go through those pre-things, you know, wait and all that good stuff. Have you noticed that when you're in that room, it's very quiet? And when you look around, people are sad? It's almost like I'm at a funeral. Seriously. I mean, you guys are alive. I mean, it's weird. And you talk quietly. It's like my little girl's like, "Shh. Why? You can talk. I mean, we're in a waiting room. There's nothing. It's not a funeral home. You're just here for the doctor." You know what I'm saying? But people get depressed, and they're sitting there depressed in a room waiting to see their doctor. Perhaps it's because of their illness. But you see, when I think about that, I think about Earth being like this big lounge or this big waiting room, waiting for our. We're just here waiting for our time to go up. But the thing is this, though. On this side of heaven, as a Christian, it shouldn't be depressing waiting to go home, and it shouldn't be sitting. We have work to do, don't we? We've been called in Matthew chapter 28 to go out and make disciples of all nations. We have things that we need to do, and that's what Jesus said. So we see here that Solomon tackles the subject of death head on. He's not afraid to talk about it. And neither should we. It's okay to talk about death. Many years ago, I used to work in Anaheim, and I had a friend, or actually a co-worker, who would make fun of me because I was a Christian. I was called Reverend, because I was going to Bible college at the time, so I was called Reverend, I was called Preacher, Bible Thumper, all this stuff, right? And it was really starting to tick me off, right? You know, I'm thinking like, okay, I'm going to get into that spirit of John the Baptist, you know, and start really going down on these guys, you know? So, anyways, we were filing, it was just him and I, just on our own, away from the main office, and we were just doing our little thing, packing boxes and whatnot, and I said, "You know what, I need to talk to this guy, because I'm getting bitter," you know what I mean? So I wanted to evangelize this guy. So I just said to him very, very gently and straightforward, I said, "Jerry," he goes, "What?" "If you were to die today, where would you go?" And the guy looked at me with this, like deer in headlights, looking at me. And he said, and he just didn't even say a word. He just went like this. You know how many people are like that? Perhaps you're here this morning. You're like, "I don't know. I don't know. If I were to die today, if God said today is your last day, I wonder if there's some in here that would say, I don't know. I hope I make it." Well, Solomon here is talking about death, and he's making it very, very clear that we will die. Proverbs 30, verse 16 says, "There are three things that are never satisfied, four that never say enough, the grave, The grave is very hungry. You know, I just recently saw that this world clock, it's called the world death clock. It's this dynamic clock that calculates the number of people who are dying in the world every second. There's this ticker going like this of all the people that are dying. I don't know how accurate it is. I didn't really do that much research, but I found it on Google. You know, if it's not in Google, it doesn't exist, so this is real. So I'm seeing this thing ticking, and I'm just overwhelmed, and it says, it is estimated that 56 million people die a year. That's a lot of people. 56 million people die. 56 million people die every year. And then I read this fascinating article about the governments around the world are kind of worried because we don't have enough earth to bury people. Did you know that? We don't have enough earth to bury people. So there's this Brazilian architect that came up with this unique, so cool thing that he called it the skyscraper cemetery idea. It's the world's tallest existing cemetery. That's it right there. It's not the Hilton. A 32-story high where tombs are rented by the year and private memorial rooms go for about $105,000. I mean, stories that the capacity here, that capacity holds 147 dead people. Governments are scared. We're running out of earth. So this, in Brazil, this guy built this thing. Could you imagine somebody going to this place thinking it's a hotel? Really? Seriously? Mom, I saw it on the internet. It's beautiful. Look at that. It's right behind this beautiful hill, you know? It's like, why are people sleeping, though? It's crazy. And we see here that people will say things like, especially Christians, oh, death is just part of life. No, it's not. Did you know that? Death is not just part of life. You know that we were created to live forever? In fact, it was our rebellion, or the wages of our rebellion and sin against God that brought death. Listen to this, Romans 5:12. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and this way death came to all because all sinned. Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We were created to live forever. Adam and Eve had an amazing relationship with God, eternally, and they blew it. They sinned. And because of that, death entered the world. Death entered the human race. That is why Jesus came to earth to die on the cross for our sins, because that's not the way God created us. We weren't supposed to die, but we do now. So Jesus conquered death. And now, as born-again people, as we've accepted Christ and the death, the sacrifice on that cross, now we have become born again, so then when I die, when I close my eyes on this side of heaven and I open them up, I'll be in eternity with Him. He's bringing me back into that relationship that was once lost in the Garden of Eden. Listen, Jesus wants to have a relationship with all of you here. You know that? And if you are not connected to Christ, if you're not connected to Jesus, if you're not following Jesus, He is bummed out because you were created to worship Him. You were created to relate to Him. You're not your own island. You're a creation of God. And He wants to bring you back into that relationship with you. And I'm going to give you an opportunity this morning towards the end for that. But that's the whole thing. Death is ugly. And we see here that Solomon is making it clear here that the only way, or actually in the New Testament, the only way to get rid of death is to get rid of sin. That's the only way to get rid of death is to get rid of sin. That day is coming. Did you know that? Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 says this, there will be no more death. I love that. How about you? There will be no more death. In eternity, people don't die. In eternity, people live forever. And it's not based on quantity, it's based on quality. It's a quality of life is what it is. Because you think about living forever, like that sounds kind of tiring because I need my nap, I get hungry, I need to eat. Listen, that's why the angels look down at us, we're like, what is going on here? These guys sleep and eat up there, they don't do any of that stuff. It's a totally different place. Well, Solomon is telling us here that life is better than death. Now again, this is where it gets a little sticky. Solomon is going to give us a perspective that is under the sun. As Christians, we know there's more to life than this life, correct? We know that when we die, there is a better heaven waiting for us. On this side of heaven is what he's talking about. He's looking at it in that way. And this is what he's saying in verses 4 through 6. Notice what it says here. He says, "But for him who is joined to all the living, there's hope. For a living dog is better than a dead lion." It's interesting, he says, that a living dog is better than a dead lion, the king of the jungle. Now, let me just explain to you what dogs were like in the time of Solomon and in Bible times. Solomon's day, dogs were the diseased mutts that ran in packs through city streets. They were not pampered like we pamper them today. Did you know that? I was recently in a Home Depot with my little four-year-old, and as I'm walking through, I actually bumped into a lady who had a big dog in there. And I'm thinking, like, do they know there's a dog in here, you know? So I'm walking by, just ignored it, and then I went to another aisle, another dog. And I'm thinking, like, is this Home Depot, right? Is this Home Depot, right? Okay. And I just had to find out why are there dogs in here? So I went to one of the clerks, and I said, excuse me, ma'am. I said, do you know there's dogs in here? Yeah, we allow dogs in here. I'm like, you're kidding me, really? Now I can't go anywhere without dogs, you know what I'm saying? Now, I forget where we were. I was at a park, and I see this couple pushing their stroller, and I'm thinking I'm going to see this beautiful little baby, you know what I mean? And as I'm walking by, you know, because I'm going to show off my little Grayson, one-year-old, I'm going to see your baby. What's that? You know, how is your hairy one? How old is he, you know? And it's like, you spent money, a stroller that's $300, to put a dog in there? I'm sorry. I love dogs. I had a dog before. It's dead now, but I had a dog. I have no problems with dogs. Cats, I could care less, but I have a dog. I had a dog. But listen, if you pamper your pets, please don't hate me. See, I'm being an object of hatred right now, probably. And I didn't see it coming. More power to you. In Bible times, dogs weren't pampered. When you saw a dog in the streets, you'd kind of be like, oh, there's a dog, get away from here. Solomon is saying this, is that a live dog is better than the king of the jungle who's dead. Why? Because the living can enjoy life while the dead can't. That's where it gets kind of weird. You're like, wait a minute, but as Christians, if we're dead, we are enjoying life. True, but this is Solomon. Solomon has a different perspective. But here's the point that he's making. There are no second chances, and I agree with that. There are no second chances. There's no purgatory. There's no reincarnation. There's no eternal reoccurrence of life. None of that stuff. The moment you die, it's over. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, that man is appointed to die once, and then after that is judgment. So there's no going back. There's no like, okay, God, bring me back. What Solomon is saying is that, listen, being alive is better than being dead, is what he's saying. Now, as a side note, this is a good passage to offer one who is contemplating suicide. Living is better than dying. Living is better than death. Why? Because relationships can be healed, sickness can be cured, work can improve. It never makes sense to take your life just because life is not treating you well. It's better to live. You know, it's sad when you hear people jumping off overpasses. That happened like a week and a half ago. There were two off the 57. Sad. Solomon is saying there's more hope for the living than there is for the dead. But of course, as Christians, we know that there is more life beyond the grave. Solomon has said that it's better to die. At the beginning of the book, he wanted just to say it's better for us to die. Here he's saying, no, there's hope for the living. He's kind of changing all of a sudden. But life is a gift from God. It really is. We should enjoy life. You know, heaven is our eternal home, but this life is very special because God created you for it. God created life. And we should enjoy life. We should take advantage of the life that God has given us. You know, Paul even said, I know, he was kind of torn. He says, you know, I want to stay here with you, but I also want to be with Jesus. And he says, which is far better. We know heaven is far better, but there's work to be done here. And I want to see my kids grow up. I want to be used on this side of heaven, because once the Lord takes me home, this whole thing here, it's done. No more preaching, no more teaching, no more Sunday Night Live, none of that stuff. I'm in eternity. I'm enjoying Jesus now. But this experience on this side of heaven is only once. And we see here that this is what he's talking about. What is lost, he says here, when you're dead, according to Solomon, rewards, presence of is lost, emotions, love, hatred, and envy in verses 5 and 6. Reality check number 3. Life is short. Life is short. Solomon reveals 5 requirements that promote living life to the fullest by using the words go, eat, drink, enjoy, and do. Notice what he says there in verse 7. Go eat your bread with joy. Drink your wine with a merry heart. For God has already accepted your works. Let your garments always be white, and let your head lack no oil. Verse 7, go and eat. Food and bread, or just bread and wine, is referring to the provisions of God. This is not giving us the license for wild living. It's not there. It's not in the text. Solomon is not saying, go out and party, go club, hang out, get drunk. That's not what it's saying here. And that's not biblical, as most of us know. What Solomon is saying, listen, you have one life to live, enjoy it. And he's going to give us some elements to that, which is kind of cool here. You're going to see it here. But the idea here is talks about meals, because meals in ancient times was very communal. And the idea here is to enjoy your meal because you never know when you're going to die. To enjoy your meal. We need to enjoy God's blessings, God's good gifts, and celebrate life with other people and quit being always in a hurry. I can't meet with you. I can't do this. I can't do that. I know people like that. They just don't have time. I don't want to be like that. I can't have dinner tonight, honey. I got to stay at work, you know, where I really can get home and eat dinner and enjoy it with my family. People are always rushing, always in a hurry. The reason Solomon gives this to us is because God has already approved your works. This means that such enjoyment is God's will for us. You know, I've had people say to me things like, you know, you Christians are weird. I'm sure you've probably had that. I said, what do you mean? He goes, you guys are like Amish. You guys don't do anything. Wait a minute, are you serious? It's like the world looks at Christianity and they think like we're supposed to be locked up in a room reading our Bibles every single second. It's like I can't enjoy a Dodger game. I can't go out and hang out at a restaurant. I can't use electricity. I have to use gas lamps and I have to find a horse and buggy. It's like, wait, that's not Christianity, man. Christianity is not about that. Christianity is loving God, serving God, loving my neighbor, and enjoying the life that God has given me in Christ. Yeah, there are some things that I have to stay away from. I mean, when you look at the Garden of Eden, when you see God said to Adam, Adam, enjoy this garden, but stay away from the one in the middle. Remember that? He gave him a parameter. He gave him a boundary. He says, listen, enjoy all the fruit. Enjoy everything here, but just get away from this tree. The same thing in life. God will say to you, listen, enjoy life, but stay away from sin. Stay away from wild living. But enjoy life. Travel. Enjoy it. And we see here, this is what Solomon is trying to drive. The point here is that this enjoyment is God's will for us. And he says in verse 7, God has already accepted. It's not sinful to enjoy life. Listen to what Jesus said, John 10:10. The thief does not come except to steal and kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I love that word. The abundant life. What does that consist of? It consists of living in Christ and enjoying his blessings. That's cool. That as a Christian, I can enjoy life. You know, I've had more fun being a Christian than being a non-Christian. Do you know that? I remember my non-Christian days. It stunk. It really did. The outer appearance of partying and clubbing and getting drunk was cool. And I remember at one time, every weekend, I remember Friday and Saturday were my days to party with my friends. I wanted to go out. Hey, what's the next club that we want to hit? Hey, where are the chicks? Hey, where do we go? And I would get drunk before I went into a club because I was cheap. I didn't want to buy the stuff inside. I sit in a car with my friend just drinking. It was crazy. It's dumb. And I go in, tweaked eye, and couldn't see what I was doing. And that happened weekend after weekend after weekend. And I got to the point where I was like, this is boring. It's like, it was almost like it was a dude, like somebody was paying me to get drunk. Somebody was paying me to have this kind of lifestyle. And it got to a point where it's like, this is not life. This is boring. This is so redundant. There's got to be more to life. Fast forward, I'm a Christian now. I love life. It's exciting to know Jesus. It's exciting to tell somebody about Christ. It's exciting to be used by God. It's fun. I love being a Christian. And my friends who are not Christians to this day, they've never experienced this life. I've been in their shoes, they've never been in my shoes. And that's the advantage you have with a non-Christian. When they try to put you against the wall, oh, really, theologically they're trying to destroy the Bible. It says, listen, I've been in your shoes. I know what it's like to drink. I know what it's like to do this and that. You've never been in my shoes. You don't know what it's like to be a Christian. But I'll tell you what it's like. You talk to people that way. It's not like you're missing out. I'm not missing out. Somebody came to me and said, oh, Rob, you're missing out, man. No, I'm not. I know exactly what's going on. I'm not missing out. Well, Solomon here says that we have a life to live, and he says, enjoy it. Notice in verse 8, garments always be white. In other words, fine garments and fine oils is what he's talking about here. Olive oil was used to refresh the face. It was used as a deodorant, perfume. And what he's saying here is, get out the best garments and fine oil. I was at a beauty supply yesterday with my wife, Karine, okay? Made sure I said that at the end. We just were hanging out. I flew in yesterday. She picked me up from the airport, and so we went out to dinner and whatnot, and then she had to get some supplies and stuff like that. And we went in there, and I was overwhelmed by all the products that you ladies buy. I just couldn't believe the colors. I mean, as a guy, I was attracted to the color and the designs of the bottles. But I'm like, there's like 20 things of this, 20 things of that, 20 things of that. And I'm like, are you guys being scammed? I'm like, you guys really use all of this? And is there a product that nobody buys? I mean, it's there on the shelf. Sorry, ladies, this is the guys thinking here. Guys are like, amen to that. Did you know that in the old days, in the Bible times, they used olive oil for all that stuff? You want to save money? Use olive oil. You can use it as deodorant, facial cream, you name it. We see here very clearly that Solomon is saying this, have a blast while you last. That's what he's saying. Have a blast while you last. And I love what he says in verse 9. Notice, he says, enjoy, he says, live joyfully with the wife whom you love all the days of your life. You know what's interesting about this? You know that Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines, 1,000 women in his life. And I find it very intriguing that he uses the word wife singular. Enjoy your wife. He probably fainted after that. He didn't say enjoy your wives. No, enjoy your wife. It's like probably thinking like, man, 1,000 women in his life. I mean, how could you do that, right? Enjoy your wife. And this is cool because he's saying basically that he's talking about, notice he uses the word vain. The word vain means fleeting, and it's referring to the shortness of life, which is our third reality check, that life is short. He says, enjoy your wife. So let me encourage you, men, enjoy your wife. Enjoy your wife. Are you enjoying your wife? And ladies, make it easy for them to enjoy you. All right? Listen, hold on, relax. No. I did not get this response from the first service, so they were in the right mindset, all right? This is where I'm going with this, all right? Wow. I lost my train of thought here because of that. I got scared. Enjoy your wife. So when your husband comes to you and says, honey, let's go out to dinner, don't say, why? Don't question him. Listen, don't block that channel of enjoyment. In other words, let him take you out. It says, get on the best garments and deck yourself out and go out for a night and enjoy. You're like, well, Robert, we have kids. So do I. I have a one-year-old and a almost five-year-old. Very active, wonderful babies. And when my mother-in-law is here, and she's in this crowd right now, thank you, Mom, my wife and I will say, hey, let's go for coffee. And I go, Carol, can you watch my four-year-old while I take the baby because she's still nursing? So we can go out for coffee. We just did this recently. It was great to talk to my wife without a little four-year-old. Mommy, daddy, mommy, daddy, mommy, daddy, mommy, daddy. You know what I'm saying? You guys know, right? You have to be strategic. You have to be purposeful. You have to find ways to enjoy your wife. And that's what Solomon is saying. Enjoy your wife. And ladies, make it easy. Say, hey, absolutely, let's go. I love Chipotle. Let's do it. Doesn't matter where you go, right? It doesn't matter as long as you guys are spending time together. That's what counts, right? Taco Bell, whatever. As long as you're both face-to-face and having a conversation and talking. I know it's a challenge in these days for marriages to have that enjoyment. It's hard. Two parents working and there's a lot of commotion and whatnot, and sometimes marriages are not doing well. But pray and enjoy each other. That's what Solomon is saying. Have a blast while you last. And he says something about your portion. Notice, this is your portion, he says. This is what God has given you. Now, where God has you today is where God wants you today. That's your portion. That's what God has given you. And I know sometimes it's very hard to accept the portion in life. Like, you're like, God, why? You know, maybe you're a person who's dealing with sickness. Maybe you're going through some issues or whatnot, and you're like, this is my portion, Robert. I don't care for this portion. But listen, trust the Lord. Just don't do what Jonah did when he did not like his portion. When God came to him and says, Jonah, I want to use you big time. I want you to evangelize the Assyrians, and I want an entire capital to get saved. And he says, nope. He went the other way. Don't do that. He rejected that portion that God was giving him. But you know what happened. God eventually brought him back. But he says to enjoy your portion. Verse 10, he says, whatever your hands finds to do, he says it very, very clearly there, and I love how he says it. He says, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might, for there is no work or device or knowledge or wisdom in the grave where you're going. Well, how do you enjoy your job? You're like, I don't like my job, Robert. I don't like my job. Give it your best effort. And remember, you're working as unto the Lord. If you give your job your best effort, with the ability that God has given you, you're going to see change in your own heart. Whatever you are able to do, do it with your heart, as unto the Lord. The word hand suggests ability. The word find suggests opportunity. And the word might suggests intensity. So what Solomon is saying is that we only have one life to make our contribution. One life. Do you know that work is a privilege? It really is. Work is a total privilege. If you don't think so, talk to someone who's been out of a job for a long time. Talk to somebody who's been unemployed for a couple years. You're going to be very privileged to have a job, especially nowadays. Solomon says, whatever your hands finds to do, do it with your might, with the ability that God has given you. Reality check number 4, and this is our last one. Life is unpredictable. Life is unpredictable. Expect the unexpected. Expect the unexpected. Verse 11, there's a list of people in 4 areas. There's a race, an athlete. There's a battle, a military service. There's a wise person. There's a person who has favor. Those who are skillful in their work are not always favored. He talks about the wise, that even though you're wise, it doesn't always guarantee that you're going to have a good earning. But generally, it's the strongest who wins. Generally speaking, it's the smartest that make more money. The skillful ones are reorganized, and the popular ones have more friends. But not always. But not always. That's what he says here. The results are uncertain here and beyond our control. Hey, listen, going to the best college, finding the best college, doesn't guarantee you wealth. Doesn't guarantee you a job. I know friends that have gone to college and they've spent tons of money and they're not in their career. So it doesn't matter where you go and what you find. It's all uncertain. It's unpredictable. Yeah, there are some that do it and they're very successful. But remember David and Goliath? This big giant versus this little guy? And if you were to see these guys, you would look and you're like, okay, there's a fight going on. A 9-foot giant versus a little guy. You're like, there's no way this guy's going to get smashed. But what happened? David won. The little guy won. So it's not always the strongest that wins. David and Goliath. Goliath had the strength. David had the faith. Totally different. God was on his side. But notice, though, the reason why this is not guaranteed, because adversity falls on everyone. Whether you're a wise person, whether you're not, whether you're a Christian, whether you're not a Christian, You're part of this. Verse 12, he says this. Notice, I want to read this. For man also does not know his time. Like fish taken in a cruel net, like birds caught in a snare, so the sons of men are snared in an evil time when it falls suddenly upon them. That's the key word in that verse. If you want to underline it, suddenly. That's the whole point right here. Suddenly. Nets and snares. There are people who go about in life thinking that they have it under control when suddenly something happens. We see that in professionals. Professionals will go through big explosions of money and whatnot, and then suddenly something happens. Perhaps you know somebody who at first was very wealthy, very, very well off, but then suddenly they were hit with a sickness and lost everything. That's the unpredictability of life. And Solomon is hitting it very well here. I mean, even with athletes. Athletes who are guaranteed millions of dollars, and suddenly they get hurt. And their career goes down the hill. They don't play anymore. Well, Solomon, in verses 13 through 18, appreciates the wisdom in others. He says it very clearly. 17 and 18, we'll close with that. Words of the wise spoken quietly should be heard rather than the shout of a ruler of fools. Wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. God's wisdom, especially God's wisdom, is really cool to see in Scripture. When God used Moses to part the Red Sea, that was wisdom. When God used Joshua to bring down those walls, that was wisdom. It wasn't through might. It wasn't through anything but God's power, His wisdom. So let me close with a few things here. One is that life on the horizontal level is unpredictable. It really is. On the horizontal level is unpredictable. We don't know what comes next. One missionary said this, and I love what he said, and I quote, "The unknown gives adventure to life." Listen, guys, as a Christian, the unknown shouldn't scare you. The unknown should excite you. Because Jesus said, don't worry about tomorrow. He is the God of your tomorrow. He already knows what's going to happen tomorrow. You trust Him with your life. Let Him be your driver, if you will. Enjoy the ride. Yeah, life is unpredictable, but when you're with Christ, you're safe. In Proverbs, it says that God is a strong tower, and the righteous run to Him and what? Are safe. Yeah, we live in a crazy world, in a chaotic world. But listen, when you're in Christ, man, there's comfort to know that God is on your side. That's the cool thing about being a Christian. I cringe when I hear people that are not Christians, you are on your own. When you go through your trials and things, you're on your own. When I go through trials and things, I got Christ's. I have somebody I can turn to and talk to and pray. It's so cool to see this because the unknown gives adventure to life, and it's so true. And the fact that our days are numbered ought to motivate us to live earnestly for Jesus. It shouldn't scare us. It should drive us to earnestly love the Lord. In light of the brevity of life, we must live with seriousness, recognizing the importance of a life well invested. And what is that about? Well, a well-invested life is one that is lived in Christ alone. Why is that important? Because life is short, death is certain. That's why. See, death is like the great equalizer. You know what I'm saying? It's like the big equalizer. Death plays no favorites, overlooks no one, regardless of your looks, regardless of your talents, regardless of your strengths, regardless of your wealth, you're going to die. That's his point. The works that we accomplish on this side of heaven is the basis of our rewards in the next. How are you investing in the kingdom? Where are you in your walk with Christ? Is it strong? Is it passionate? Or is it like, I just come to church and go home? And then I come back and think of God next Sunday. The question that you have to ask yourself is this: are you living for Jesus? Are you living for Jesus? I'm not asking, do you know Jesus? Because you may know of Jesus, but do you truly know Him and are you living for Him?